In this session, we are going to learn about set theory. Set theory is generally asked either for 1 mark or for 5 marks in bank exams. And this is a very simple topic which can easily fetch you 5 marks in less than 2 minutes. So let us understand what is set theory all about. Set theory is a branch of mathematical logic which is used to study sets. And sets are nothing but a well-defined collection of objects. Let us first understand what are some examples of sets. Now, as I mentioned, a set is a collection of well-defined objects, right? Some examples of sets are as follows here. Now, for example, set of natural numbers. A set of natural numbers is denoted by n, which includes 1, 2, 3, 4, up to infinity. That means this set has got all the natural numbers. And each of this number here is called the element of the set. Likewise, set of whole numbers, which is denoted by W, has got the elements 0, 1, 2, 3, up to infinity. So this set has got all the whole numbers, that is numbers from 0 up to infinity, or integers from 0 up to infinity. Then we have set of integers denoted by I, which has got 0, plus or minus 1, plus or minus 2, plus or minus 3, and so on up to infinity. Then likewise, we have set of even numbers and set of odd numbers, that is set of even numbers has got 2, 4, 6, 8 up to infinity, and odd numbers has got elements 1, 3, 5, 7 up to infinity. So all these are examples of sets. These are nothing but collection of some numbers, collection of well-defined objects, right? And here each of these numbers which belongs to the set is called element of the set. As you can see here in the first 5 examples, the number of elements in each of the sets are infinite. And hence these are called as infinite sets. For example, if you look at set of natural numbers, it is 1, 2, 3, 4 up to infinity. That means it has got infinite elements, and hence it is called an infinite set. Likewise, in all the remaining cases, we have got infinite elements, and hence all these are referred as infinite sets. Apart from infinite sets, the other type of sets that we have are finite sets, where the number of elements are finite. For example, let's say there is a set called A which has got the elements 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5. So there are only 5 elements here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Likewise, there is a set B which has got the elements 3, 4, 6, 9, 12 and 15. So there are 6 elements in the set B. So these two are referred as finite sets as they have got finite number of elements. So these are finite sets. The other point that we need to understand here is, a set need not necessarily have only numbers as its elements. For example, we can say that there is a set of all the letters in the English alphabet. So this set here has got the letters of English alphabet, but not numbers as its elements. Likewise, we can say that there is a set of all Indians. So here, the elements of the set are persons. Or we can say there is a set of Americans. So here, all the elements in the set are persons from America. So this is how a set is nothing but a collection of objects, a well-defined collection of objects. It can be numbers or letters or persons or any other type of objects. Let us now look at some of the important operations that can be performed on 2 different sets. Let's take 3 different sets as follows. For example, the set A here has got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 as its elements. Set B has got 3, 4, 5, 7, 9. Set C has got 9, 12, 15, 18 and 21 as its elements. Now here the first operation that we have is union of sets. Union of 2 sets A and B is denoted by A union B as shown here. And it is the set of all elements that is either in A or in B or in both A and B. So when we take A union B, we need to consider all those elements which belong to either A or B or both A and B together. For example, if we take the 2 sets A and B as shown here, A union B can be taken as 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 7 and 9. Why? Because 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 all belong to A. 3, 4, 5, 7, 9 all belong to B. So collection of all the elements that belong to either A or B or both A and B is referred to as A union B. And it is denoted by A union B as shown here. Next one here is intersection of sets. Intersection of 2 sets A and B is denoted by A intersection B as shown here, and it is the set of all those elements that belong to both A and B. That means when we take intersection of 2 sets, we need to consider only those elements which are present in both A and B as well. So if we take A and B as the given sets here, A intersection B will be equal to 3, 4, 5. Why? Because 3, 4 and 5 are the elements which are present in both A and B as well. So intersection of two sets is nothing but collection of all those elements which are present in both the sets. Likewise, we can have intersection of three sets, A intersection B intersection C. So here we take only those elements which are present in all the three sets. So whenever we go for intersection, we need to take common elements of all the given sets. For example, let's say we have to find out B intersection C. Now in B intersection C here, you see that the elements which are common is only 9. 9 is present in set B as well as it is present in set C. So when we take B intersection C, the only element that we have here is 9. Or if we take A intersection C, if you take A intersection C, the elements in A are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and that in C are 9, 12, 15, 18, 21. You find that there is nothing common between A and C. So A intersection C will be equal to a null set. A null set is nothing but that set which has got nothing in it. Therefore, there is no object in a null set. So A intersection C here will be equal to null set. The next operation that we have here is disjoint sets. Disjoint sets, two sets A and B are said to be disjoint. They are disjoint from each other if A intersection B is equal to null set. So whenever there is no intersection between two sets, or whenever the intersection of two sets results in a null set, then those two sets are referred as disjoint sets. That means there is no connection between these two sets. They are completely disjoint from each other. There is no overlapping. For example, if you take these three sets here, the two disjoint sets that we have are A and C. Why? Because A and C share no common element among them. So A intersection C is a null set, hence A and C are called disjoint sets. B and C are not disjoint sets. Why? Because B intersection C will be equal to 9. The set B intersection C will have one element 9. And hence, they are not disjoint sets. So disjoint sets are two sets where there is no common element between them. The last one here is difference of sets. Difference of two sets A and B is denoted by A minus B. And this is the set of all elements that belong to A but not to B. So whenever we take A difference B or difference of two sets, we need to consider all the elements that are in A but not in B. Likewise, let's say we have to consider the difference of two sets R and P. So here R minus P denotes all those elements which are there in R but not in P. For example, taking these three as the given sets, A difference B here will be equal to 1 and 2, a set which consists of 1 and 2. Why? Because 1 and 2 are the elements which are there in A and the remaining elements, as you can see, are there in B as well. So we need to consider only those elements which are there in A, but that should not be in B. So as 3, 4 and 5 belong to B, it cannot be taken in the difference of sets. Likewise, B difference A will be equal to 7 and 9. Why? Because from B, we need to subtract or we need to remove those elements which are there in A. So 3, 4, 5 are there in A. So B difference A will result in 7 and 9. And from this, you can understand that A difference B is not equal to B difference A. A difference B is 1 and 2. B difference A is 7 and 9. So A difference B and B difference A are not equal to each other. And B difference C. Let's take B difference C. So B difference C should have all those elements that are there in B but not in C. So if we take all the elements of B here which are not in C, we should remove 9. Why? Because 9 is the element that is present in set C as well. So the remaining elements can be taken as B difference C. That is 3, 4, 5 and 7. So that results in the set B difference C. So these are some of the important operations which can be performed on sets. Union of sets, intersection of sets, difference of sets, or what are two disjoint sets. And out of all these operations, the most important ones here are union of sets and intersection of sets. Why? Because when it comes to bank exams, the type of questions that we get involves either union of sets or intersection of sets. So make sure that you are very clear with what is union of two sets and what is intersection of two sets. Union of two sets is all those elements which are there in first set or in second set or in both the sets. Whereas intersection of two sets are all those elements which are present in both the sets, that is first set and second set as well. After learning about sets and the various types of operations that can be performed on two sets, let us now see how can these operations on sets be represented with the help of diagrams. Generally, we use Venn diagrams or set diagrams to show all the possible logic relations between a finite collection of sets. So let us see how can we show various types of sets and their relationships with the help of Venn diagrams. In case of Venn diagrams, a universal set is represented by a rectangle and a subset is represented by a circle within the rectangle. For example, as you can see in the first diagram here, the rectangle shows the universal set. That is nothing but the complete set or the total number of elements. And any subset is represented with a circle inside the rectangle. That is, a circle here is nothing but a part of the universal set. So as you can see, this complete rectangle, whatever comes inside the rectangle is the total number of elements. And whatever comes within this circle are those elements which belong to the set A. The remaining part of the rectangle here is shown by A dash, which is read as A complement. Now A complement here shows all those elements which belong to the universal set, but they are not a part of the set A. So as you can see here, the complete set, universal set, has been divided into two regions. One is the set A. So this shows all the elements that belong to set A. And the other region shows all those elements that does not belong to the set A. And is represented by A dash. Now the second diagram here shows how can we represent two disjoint sets. As we have learned, disjoint sets are those where the intersection is a null set. That means there is no common part between two disjoint sets. Let us understand this with the help of a diagram. Let's say the universal set here is natural numbers. That means universal set is nothing but all the numbers from 1 to infinity, all the integers from 1 to infinity. Now we know that all the natural numbers can be classified either as prime numbers or composite numbers except the number 1. So here, if we take one set as prime numbers and other set as composite numbers, then the complete diagram will be as shown. Now as you can see here, the universal set is all the natural numbers, out of which one part shows all the prime numbers and the other circle shows all the composite numbers. And we know that there is no common part between prime numbers and composite numbers. A number is either prime or it is composite. It cannot be both prime and composite at the same time. So that is the reason there is no overlapping between these two sets, or these two sets do not overlap each other. So this region shows all prime numbers. The other region shows all composite numbers. And the left out region which we see here is nothing but the number 1. Why? Because the number 1 is neither a prime number or a composite number. It does not participate in any of these two categories. So this is how we can show two disjoint sets. Universal set is natural numbers. One subset shows prime numbers, the other subset shows composite numbers. And the left out region can be taken as a number 1 as it is neither a prime nor a composite number. So that's how representation of sets can be done with the help of Venn diagrams. Remember, always universal set is a rectangle, and within that we can show various subsets with the help of different circles. If there is nothing which is left out after drawing the various sets, then we can say that this region will be equal to 0, or this region is a null set as there is nothing inside that region. Let us now look at the representation where two sets overlap each other, or there is a common part or an intersection exists between two different sets. For example, let's say the universal set here is the students in a class. Now all these students in the class is represented inside the rectangle. So this complete rectangular region shows the total number of students in the class. Let us now say the students of the class play hockey or cricket or both, and there are some students who do not play any of these games. So how do we represent such a case with the help of Venn diagrams? Now here, as already discussed, the rectangle shows the total number of students in the class. Now there is one circle denoted by capital A which shows the number of students that play hockey. So here the first circle is that which is talking about students playing hockey. Then we have a circle which shows the number of students playing cricket, and it is denoted by capital B. So these are the two circles here, or we can say these are the two sets, set A and set B. Set A here is all the students playing hockey, set B is all the students playing cricket. Now since we know that there are some students who can play hockey as well as cricket, we try to overlap these two sets, or we try to draw these two circles in such a way that they intersect each other. And that intersecting region, as you can see here, the intersection between the two sets is this part. So that intersection of two circles or intersection of two sets there shows those students who play both hockey as well as cricket. And the left out region, apart from these two circles, the left out region here represents those students who do not play any of these two games. So if you try to observe properly, we have got four different regions in the universal set. One region is small a, the other region is small c, then we have one region which is small b, and the fourth region here is small d. Let us now understand what does each of these regions represent from the given Venn diagram. Now if you observe, small a here is the region which shows students playing only hockey. As you can see, small a is only that region which is hockey but not cricket. That means if you remove the set cricket, left out region is called as hockey. So this is A, which shows the students playing only hockey. Remember, there is a difference between students playing hockey and students playing only hockey. If you observe, the students playing hockey, total here is A plus B. Why? Because whatever comes inside this circle is the number of students playing hockey. So what do we find here? A and B within the first circle A. So A plus B is the total number of students playing hockey. That is what is given here. Total number of students playing hockey is A plus B. But the number of students who play only hockey is represented by small a, this region small a. Why? Because these are the students who play hockey but not cricket. So that is why they are called students playing only hockey. And there is a huge difference between both these cases. That means students playing hockey and students playing only hockey. So never confuse between these two terms. When we specify the word only, it means we are talking about students who play only that game and no other game. And when the word only is not given, it means the students there can play hockey as well as the other game. So hockey is A plus B, whatever comes inside the first circle A, and only hockey is the region A. Similarly, the number of students playing cricket is shown by the set B or the circle B. Now whatever comes inside the circle B is the number of students playing cricket. So B plus C or C plus B is the number of students playing cricket. But then the number of students who play only cricket is the region which is shown only by the part C here. So C is that region which shows the students who play only cricket. So students playing only cricket here is shown by C. So again, if you can observe, only cricket is C and cricket will be B plus C. Now this particular region B, which we have understood as the intersection part, shows that region who play both cricket as well as hockey. So students playing both cricket and hockey is shown by the region B. So that particular leaf like structure which comes after the intersection of the two circles shows the students who play both hockey as well as cricket. And then, as we have learned, the left out region D shows those students who neither play hockey nor cricket. So whatever comes out of the two circles here shows those students who play neither hockey nor cricket. So D is that part, neither hockey nor cricket is shown by D. Now if you try to observe, the total number of students in the class is composed of four regions, A, B, C and D. So we can say that total is equal to A plus B plus C plus D, where A is the number of students playing only hockey, B is the number of students playing both hockey and cricket, C is the number of students playing only cricket, and D is the number of students playing none of these two games. Remember, it is not necessary that there should be some value for D. D can sometimes become zero if all the students play at least one of the games. So depending on the question, we can decide whether D should exist or not. If each student plays at least one of the games or minimum one game, then none of the games region will become zero. So D there can be taken as zero. But otherwise, in general, total should be taken as A plus B plus C plus D. So in general, when we solve one mark questions, this is the formula to be used. That is, total number of elements or total number of students should be equal to set A, the number of students in set A plus number of students in set B minus those students who are there in both set A as well as set B. That is nothing but intersection of set A and set B plus none of set A and set B. That means this is the region which is out of both the sets or out of both the circles. So simply remember that total will be equal to A plus B minus both AB plus none, where A and B are nothing but two different sets. For example, as in this case, A represents the number of students playing hockey and B represents the number of students playing cricket. Likewise, in some cases, the two different sets are given in terms of coffee or tea. That is, some people have coffee, some people have tea. So in that case, we can say that total will be equal to set A plus set B minus both AB plus none, where A is the set representing number of people having coffee and B is the set which represents number of people having tea. So number of people who have coffee plus number of people who have tea minus those people who have both coffee and tea plus those people who have neither coffee nor tea. So always for two given categories, for two different sets, we can take total as A plus B minus both AB plus none. If you observe properly, the formula that is given here is quite similar to what we had learned in elementary set theory in school. That is, n of A union B should be equal to n of A plus n of B minus n of A intersection B. So that's like a mathematical equation, and here we have a simple formula in terms of A and B. The proof for this formula can be taken as follows. We know that total or the universal set here is nothing but region A plus region B plus region C plus region D. So why are we using this formula? How does it satisfy the given equation? Let's understand. Now as you can see here, this A here is the set A. And set A in the given diagram is A plus B. So it can be taken as A plus B plus the set B is nothing but B plus C. Minus both A and B is the region B, small b, plus none of A and B is the region D. So if we try to simplify this, we find that plus B and minus B gets cancelled. And we are left out with A plus B plus C plus D. So that is the proof for this formula. From the diagram, we very well understand that the universal set or the total number of students will be equal to A plus B plus C plus D. And from this formula as well, we find that the total comes out to be the same.